ZANU-PF Electoral Commission or ZANU-PF Electoral Committee. Zaki Zunarawa Zimbabwe Electoral Commission.
For councillors. The results are out. Welcome to this edition of Free Talk, where we discuss the importance of these results to democracy, where we also look at the electoral processes and see if anything needs to be changed, improved, or all has to be kept as it is. Now, this is the future in proud partnership with the Frederick Newman Foundation, and in studio to help me discuss this and to give more context and more flesh to the March 26 by-elections is the spokesperson for ZANU-PF, Comrade Christopher Mchangwa. Thank you and welcome.
Hello, good evening, good afternoon, Free Talk.
Amazing. And I'm also joined by Job Saro Wiwa from the CCC, the Triple C, the new baby in town. Thank you very much and welcome to the Free Talk.
No, thank you very much, a blessing for inviting us to this Free Talk. I think we are going to have a very important discussion concerning the political developments recently witnessed by the world in our country.
Amazing. Now, I just want to start from both political parties. ZANU-PF, what is the significance of the results that came out in the March 26th by-elections for you as a party?
Well, the most important is that Zimbabweans once again got an opportunity to exercise their democratic right to choose who should represent them in a number of constituencies. Zimbabwe has got a very proud tradition of homegrown democracy. I always emphasize the point that we were the first national liberation movement to choose to get to office by the ballot box as opposed by the bullet. We didn't do from Bush to office in 1979-1980. We decided to go for the electorate to choose who should be the ruler of Zimbabwe. So we have a pedigree of democracy in Zimbabwe. And for the past 42 years, we have unfailingly discharged our democratic credentials for the world to see. And this is exactly what happened on Saturday, on the 26th of March. We are happy with the outcome of the results. First, is a vindication of the national institutions of Zimbabwe that they are capable of discharging the democratic process freely and fairly to the to the free choice of the electorate. Secondly, we are very happy with the harvest of seats which we got, two additional ones, because they were previously with the opposition, including the NPF one in Kwekwe, but also a clutch of council seats in urban areas, which have previously been neglected to the benefit of the MDC Triple C alliance. So for that gain, we are vindicated that we are on the right course, and it's a good pointer to 2023 national harmonized elections, where we hope to actually whitewash the opposition.
Now, coming to you as Triple C, what importance are these results to you? What do they shed for you?
The first thing is that these results have demonstrated to the people of Zimbabwe that we are the democratic alternative in this country, and also that the people of Zimbabwe are now ready to mandate the new order in our country. We were just a new baby, 2 months old, after having everything thrown on us. We have been able to stand on our feet, re-strategize and come back very strong. It is not common whereby a political party of 2 months who to give such an electoral performance, despite having been stopped to hold our rallies. There is not any political party which was contesting these previous elections which has been stopped to hold its public gatherings except our political organization. We have been banned in almost about 11 rallies in this country, where we have been stopped for us to access the electorate. You knew what happened in Kokwe when our rally was stopped. You knew what happened in Binga. You knew that even in Mashingo, we had to be given reprieve by the courts of our country. And you also know that even in Marondera, we have been stopped to come in. Another rally was stopped to be conducted in St. Mary's. And also, you know that even Epworth, we had to hold that rally after we have obtained reprieve again from the court. So, despite everything having been thrown against us, the people of Zimbabwe clearly demonstrated that they are now of strong spine. They are prepared to weather all the dictatorial tenets that have been thrown against them for them to triumph and install a government that respects the citizens of our country. And the citizens have now demonstrated that the electoral politics now belongs to them, where they are the center to make decisions on behalf of who should govern this country. And also in terms of our electoral performance, 19 out of 28, you know, it's a whitewash. We have whitewashed our opponents. Those seats that have been on the table for contestation, ourselves entering as a new political organization, demonstrated that we are the only game in town. And we are ready for 2023. And like what my brother said, we are ready to have a very civilized contestation in 2023, minus trying to throttle other political parties from conducting their political business, as they have never been stopped to engage in their political activities. I think also they will reciprocate to make sure that ourselves would also be able to hold our political activities without hindrance in our country. If the independence that we all fought for, and which all our parents and our forefathers fought for in this country, is for all of us to be given an opportunity to have one man, one vote. We must, all of us as Zimbabweans, have been given an opportunity for us to exercise that right, which was the main and the utmost agenda for the liberation struggle.
I'll come back to you. I just want to come to Comrade Mtangwa. Your party has insisted that the CCC is not a new political party. Here, Honorable Wiwa says that it's a new baby, it has been in existence for 2 months, and it didn't lose any seats, as you were saying, that you took two seats from the opposition, didn't lose any seats. In fact, it gained 19 seats.
Well, the truth is that until recently, when they fell out with each other and started brawling over the name of the party and started expelling each other, Chamisa was MDC, Tsvangirai. He snatched the leadership in a violent manner in Bulera, you know, in 2017 at the expense of the then Vice President Kupe, Madame Kupe. Everybody knows the ugly scenes which went on, the unseemly ugly scenes which went on at the funeral of the late iconic democratic fighter Mugen Tsvangirai, who incidentally was a very close acquaintance of mine in political terms. So they inherited the mantle of the MDC. It's just that they were denied the name. So to the electorate, they tried to be a new baby, but they were wearing all their old rags. Everybody could see the old the beard, which was in the CCC. And it was judged according to the record of the MDC, because that's what they've been identified with until this particular election, until Mwanzora denied them the name. And their record of urban administration is the most sordid you can ever imagine in the history of this country since 2022. Garbage is all over town. Sewage, children swim in sewage. Water, there's no running water. 20 years of MDC rule, no jobs, because the investment starts at local government level, not at national government level. People look for a place to do business. And those who run cities are the ones who should be responsible for the development of business. None of that in the record of the MDC and CCC. I can go on and on. You know, they've covered, they thought going to townhouse was to allocate themselves every piece of land that is available. Nothing for entertainment. Kids cannot entertain. So the crowds which they talk about is just young people looking for entertainment, because the city fathers who are MDC for 2 decades have not done nothing to make young people feel that they are part of the city. And equally, the electorate has not seen that these people are not responsible. They all, you know, their leader, Nelson, is focused on one agenda, going to State House. Even if he's given a mandate to run cities and towns, he doesn't care. He only cares that one day I'll be at State House. So eventually that has caught up with the MDC, even if they shed their name, and they shed like a snake. You, you shed off your skin, you tried to be triple C. The sordid record is still there, and it was attached to them by the electorate. That's why we won a clutch of urban constituencies in areas which had never done before. That's why we snatched two, one urban and one peri-urban. We almost got the one from St. Mary's from him. Look at our showing in St. Mary's. So they are now being made to account for their record, because the same candidates who were with the MTC are the ones who are in the triple C. You understand? So if the personalities are the same, the leadership is the same, what's in the change of a name?
Over to you.
No, you know, I mean, it's embarrassing because I think my brother Chaba knows everything that they have been planning, and they plotted to make sure that they took the MDC from the people who have been in that leadership and gave it to someone via a series of manipulations of the judiciary, manipulations of the national institutions like the army and also the police, and also for the benefit of the public. The plan and plot for them to defrock ourselves of the MDC entitlement by ZANU-PF, who became the center player in thinking that if they are going to overthrow ourselves from the MDC, we were going to, the people of Zimbabwe were going to be homeless and find no any alternative for them to choose to leave this country. We their plans and plots, they have been written all over the place. We, the people of Zimbabwe, know how ZANU-PF manipulated, they become the center in involving itself in the destruction and destabilization of the MDC, and hand it over to Douglas Mantua. We obtained a security report, and now making it public to the people, directly from ZANU-PF headquarters. When they were still planning and plotting, after our Quebec Congress in May 2019, where they were planning on the way how to take over the MDC after the Supreme Court judgment, how they were going to involve the military in the taking over of harvest house, how they were going to make sure that the Supreme Court judgment was going to be used to recall and destroy members of parliament who had been elected on the MDC alliance, and everything was authored, planned and executed from Sheikh building, and all of those things we have them. We have been obtaining these security reports directly from the people who have been working in the POF's office, and also we have been working at the ZANU-PF headquarters. After having obtained that security report, I went and tabled it before my president, Advocate Nelson Jamisa, and also we had an opportunity for him to share with champion Charlton Wende to say, this is the ZANU-PF plot, here is the report we have obtained. This is an authentic report, and everything that has been prescribed in that document, the way how it has been reported to us, the way of how they were going to executing the plan, came out exactly like how we have been given that security report. So everything that happened was ZANU-PF's attempt to destroy the aspirations of our people in Zimbabwe by hijacking the MDC, by taking the MDC to become its surrogate, so that it would be an extension of the ZANU-PF branch. And we all know how the military and also the police have been involved in the taking over of Harvest House during the old hours.
But are you a new party?
We are a completely new party, which you all know that we are a new launched political organization. You would not say, because the majority of the players who have been involved in the previous team are still the same. It's like, for example, Chelsea changed its name to Manchester United. And then when it comes in counting the championship that the new Manchester United team has won, is since the day when it became Manchester United. You cannot count the championships that were won when the team was called when the other players were playing for Manchester United, when the players now are playing for a new football team, you would say, ah, it is the same, it's the same football team. It's absolutely a total different political outfit. It's a new, with a new ideology, with a new political setup. And our ideology, we laugh a lot when some people try to allege that we don't have an ideology. Our ideology is very clear, that now the citizens are at the center. We are seeing every decision in this country, whether it will be political, whether it will be in the election of people into public office. The citizens are the ones who are going to carry all the decisions in our country. Not a few elite leadership at the top, like what happens in Zambia, where Politburo would think that they own Zimbabwe and make decisions on behalf of the people of Zimbabwe. Ours is that the citizen is now at the center. The citizen is now the one that carries the burden of making sure on how the country is going to be run. And they know it. The MDC alliance, which they desperately wanted, is still there with their president, Douglas Monjora, with their full superstructure, Morgan Communities, the national chairman, Mutsuri as the vice president. So for them trying attempting to say we are still the MDC alliance, is desperation. What is the new in actual fact? That we are a purely new political party that gave its first shot on electoral political contest in the recent by-elections. And our performance is still astonishing. They are still surprising at section building, how we drugged them, where they are running 10 seats short of ourselves. We have got 19 seats, they have got 9. They are our junior players in as far as the current political setup in the country is concerned. And come 2023, that will be emphatically going to be sent home by the citizens of our country. Clearly, we are the majority political organization which must govern this country by the results of the recent general elections.
Now, I want to come to you, Comrade Ntagwa, and maybe just move to the issues that you raised. You said the sordid past of urban mismanagement of urban and local authorities. What is the role of government in making sure that, because we have seen central government blaming local authorities for the failures of local authorities, but not taking any responsibilities for the failure of national assets, ZESA, NRZ? What is the responsibility of national government in making sure that the country is ticking?
Well, he has given an analogy of Manchester United or whatever, Chelsea, changing a name. You know, ultimately, the people who choose the identity of a party are the voters, not the political leaders when they go to vote. It is the voters. And the voters in this country were choosing between MDC moved into CCC and ZANU-PF. So their record of the past.
So you're saying MDC alliance, which was also in that election, was non-existent?
Well, look, they were their factions. He has spoken a lot about what he thinks was the conspiracy behind this or that or that. If people decide to feud in their party...
No, but the most important question, Blessing,
can I allow you to...
I want him to clarify for me, not that I'm disturbing him. Are you saying, Brother Mchango, MDCT no longer exists?
I would rather...
No,
that is what I want to hear from my brother.
I would rather answer to the...
That's why I just wanted to be clarified on that.
If we start asking each other questions, I don't know whether it will help the audience come to any... the clarity on the issues at stake. The truth is that if the fans who were formerly Chelsea follow the new Chelsea and cheer the new Chelsea, it means they know that it is their team regardless of the gap it has, regardless of the color of the uniform it has taken. So the electorate went to the votes this time knowing that they were choosing between CCC, which has moved out of the MDC. That's exactly how they went. If they feud among themselves, well, we can't help that. It is their business to feud, and it is also our business to unite, which we do. We don't do what they do. When there's an election in ZANU-PF, we choose one leader. in their party, everybody goes to the leadership contest wanting to be president. Nobody ever wants to be a chief, no Indian. That's why the party, that's why we say it has no ideology. And they have acknowledged, even his leaders himself acknowledged that they don't care about ideology. But when the electorate made choices this time, they knew that all the seats had been held by the MDC, and the personalities in his party were the previous MPs. They were the previous councillors from the MDC. They were wearing the MDC garb, which he proudly dons even as he was speaking. He spoke for districts only about his MDC background. And now he wants to say maybe that they've changed the name, they're different. So the electorate chose the councillors and the MPs according to their record and according to the record of their party. Since ZANU-PF, its people had died, we had 7 seats. Out of the 7 seats which we contested, we increased our majority. That's where the whitewash was. On the other hand, there were 21 seats which belonged to the MDC, and we contested those seats. They were in urban areas, which was previously MDC, now TCC. The electorate judged them accordingly. We got 2 out of their 21. So they ended up with 19. For us, it is an inflection point. But even more exciting was the fact that we got a clutch of council seats, which means finally the urban electorate is beginning to hold them account for the solid record. They were given $144 million as a loan, which they signed for from China, for Botton Jaffrey waterways. Not even a single pump was bought, not even a single pipe was laid by an MDC council, which was running a townhouse in Harare. Not even one pump. Now the electorate has no running water, sewage is all over. In the rain season, cars become boats, peddling in roads. The roads have disappeared when it is the dry season. Nature has reclaimed those roads. This is, your primary duty as an urban councillor is to make life better for the urban people. And the constitution of this country is very clear about the delineation of responsibilities between the central government and the local authorities. We were appalled as a party to the extent that we had to assume presidential powers simply to have a leeway of starting paving the roads, which they have neglected for 2 decades. 2 decades
in. But central government is the one that collects money for roads to the scenario.
No. See, ratepayers. Ratepayers pay for the maintenance. Remember, a city is supposed to become a self-supporting entity. Every city in the world has got an identity. Yokohama supplies Toyotas to the world. Silicon Valley supplies software to the world. You go to Surat, they supply diamond rings to the world. Every city has got an identity as to what is the purpose of that city. Every town in this world strives to give an identity so that they sell to the local market, they sell to the national market, they sell to the regional market, and they sell to the global markets. That is what the city is about. It's about producing good quality goods, world-class quality goods for the urban market, for the discerning global market. That's what a city is for. Under 2 decades of FDC rule, Harare has lost an identity completely. No new products, no new brand names, nothing to write about Harare as a place which has got its rightful place in global commerce. This is the solid record, which means that there are no jobs for young people because the city is failed. When a businessman lands in a country, lands at an airport, when he goes to invest, he looks for a place has got a local authority. It has an identity, it has an address. The local authority is responsible. They don't even know that it is their responsibility. All they know, Nelson, is can I go to State House? Even if he wins, he doesn't care about the wins which he has been given. If he had run this city well, and all the cities well, the MDC would be sitting on laurels of excellence for running cities with new products written, made in Zimbabwe, in Harare, in Bulawayo, in Kwekwe, in Mutare. None of that from this part. And then, of course, the electorate came 26 March. They clobbered them. We have increased our votes in urban areas. We have got 2 seats in urban areas. It's an inflection point. It's a point of departure. We not necessarily, when you are coming out of a deep well, you really don't want to be at the roof of the mountain roof. You just want to be on the surface. And that's where we are. Everybody is beginning to see and compare them. But the rural vote, which is our mainstay, we solidified. We say, wash out, they got nothing. They never got a seat from us. So look, old wine in new bottles is still old wine, regardless of the new bottles.
Allegations that you failed to run cities and you've been punished for it.
No, the first thing that I want to be very clear to your blessing is that we are not the MDC. The MDC is Douglas Mojora and this team. That's why they lost at the recent elections. The mayor of Harare at the present moment is the one that who belongs to the MDC of Douglas Mojora. We are not associated in any way with the performance of the councillors of the MDC. Those belongs to Douglas Mojora. We are the Triple C. So for him to compare us with the failures of Douglas Mojora, council is really astonishing. They must. That's why they have lost the elections to Triple C in Harare. Both Douglas Mojora and Zanu-PF, on the basis that the Zimbabwean people want a new, and the new is being brought by the Triple C. We are very happy with our performance in terms of the local government elections. The people of our metropolitan cities are now giving the new mandate and their new faith to the new baby on the radar, and we are happy, and we should be measured through our performance as the Triple C. We have brought back our councillors, we have our councillors now into local authorities who are now running to, who are now going to perform. And that is the performance that you want to be measured with. But also, for a long time, we should never overlook the way how the ZANU-PF government has been destabilizing the way our local authorities have been running this country. We know since the period of Ignatius Chombo, via the period of other ministers of local government, how they have been interfering with the way how local authorities have been run. There have been a lot of destabilization, especially in the city of Harare, where no single mayor has ever completed his term of office for him to be given, to be measured after the completion of his 5-year term. From 2000 to 2005, when the opposition had a mayor in Harare, the mayor was fired. And when the other mayor came in office, he was fired. We know the history that recently our mayors in Harare have been always being suspended. We left, right, and center by July Moy. July Moy has been one of the people who have caused the current rotten in our urban areas. He tried to usurp the powers of the local authorities. Our mayor, Jacob Mafume, was suspended and unlawfully after all, and having spent 45 days without instituting the internal tribunal, which is prescribed by the Urban Councils Act, nothing takes place. He is just kept on suspension ad infinitum with no action, simply to destabilize that if our mayors are allowed to perform the duties and roles prescribed to them in terms of the law, the ZANU-PF will be embarrassed. So the level of destabilization, the level of their fear of our ability to turn around misgovernance that has been taking place in our country. Like, for example, you have given very important examples. Why is GMB now a rotting institution? Where its depots are now areas for birds to make nests? Why is our railway lines looking like the ones that were constructed by Cecil John Rhodes in 1894, when he had the dream of a railway line from Cape to Cairo? Do we ever obtain new railway infrastructure from 1980 to present, only 42 years in power? What have they done with the issues of providing electricity to our citizens? SESA is now a completely rotten institution, complete collapse, people living in darkness most of the hours per day. 18 hours of people in urban areas are living in darkness because SESA is no longer able to supply electricity to its citizens. And how would a government that has created 90% unemployment, a record in the world at the present moment, even the most poorest and most misgoverned states do not have more than 90% unemployment like the one that we currently have in our country. If you go and visit our industrial areas in Willowville today, and if you go to Lawayo in Belmont, you realize that our gigantic industries have completely and totally collapsed. They have now become white elephants. Nothing is materializing in our country. Here is the new, where we are saying to the citizens of our country, we are going to have rapid industrialization in our country, where our people will be able to participate in the economy of their country. Here is now an opportunity for you to choose a clean leadership that has not been involved in corruption. We know how much has been looted in our country by the political elite in our country. We know the gold that has been smuggled out of the country, which has been predicted by the Reserve Bank of Zimbabwe to be worth $100 million every month. And if you calculate that amount of money that has been looted out of our country, you'll be astonished. Up to now, nobody knows that our diamond revenues, what are they being used for? They have now created an airport at Chiazwa, where diamonds are being, after being mined, are flown directly from Chiazwa to China with no accountability. How much are we obtaining as a country? It is one that the gold industry at the present moment is now being privatized by the corrupt elite. Where you will find that one individual will sell 7 tons of gold just at a go when the majority of citizens are starving in the streets. It's absolutely abominable. There is no any corrupt government in the world more than the current, more than those who are governing the state of affairs in Uganda. And he knows it, my brother knows that.
I want to give you an opportunity to have a direct response to the allegations.
Well, it's a litany of half-truths, a litany of falsehoods, and also it doesn't take cognizance of the dramatic changes which have happened with the coming in of the Second Republic in 2017. Maybe because he was a little bit in the periphery of MDC at that particular time. He doesn't know the role which his former president, the late Tsvangirai, discharged in the rebirth of the Second Republic. The MDC previously had tried to unseat Mugabe as he became old, corrupt, and responsible for all this litany of abuses which he's talking about.
You accept this litany of abuses?
Yes, that's why we do. I took center stage. You know, since 2014, you know, there's a lot of which is still classified, which I would be happy to start revealing to the Zimbabwean public as to what the war veterans, who have always been the game changers in the history of this country, did after they spent more than 20 years trying to unseat Mugabe to no avail. We just decided to do it because we have a pedigree of doing that. We made Zimbabwe. That's our pedigree. And when things could definitely begin to go wrong, we intervened as war veterans. I was the chairman. So I can't be told about changes which I was responsible for by somebody who is a rank outsider. That's why I'm saying he may not be privy to what Tsvangirai and us did to make sure that Mugabe goes. And since that departure point in 2017, in 2018, the things which he's talking about have been corrected. That's why we can get more votes in rural areas than them. They never could get a seat in the last election. Remember, the last arbiter, the most important arbiter in democracy. That's why I said we've got democratic pedigree since 1980, is the voter. If this is true, about what he's saying, we would have lost Dismal in the rule of what? They would have snatched the 7 seats which belonged to us. They couldn't as an opposition. He works his lyrical about the victimization of the MTC, owning up to the fact that they are triples in the MTC. He's owning up. He laments Mfumi, he laments this one, he laments that one. These are the same people who, if we're going to be calling elections tomorrow, they will be fielded by the Triple C as their candidates. So it is the same old wine in new bottles. And the electorate is not a fool. That's why they clobbered them for their episodic bad record. They did. But anyway, coming to, he may not be proved. I was the one who turned around the leaf tobacco industry in this country as ambassador of tobacco in China. So by bringing the largest tobacco company in the whole world, and for almost since 2005, the biggest foreign currency earnings have been coming from the leaf tobacco industry, the golden leaf. I know what happened because I was at the center of it to revive that industry. The gold industry, 2014, 2013, we made a resolution in the War Veterans that Mugabe and his cronies were wrong in stopping young people from mining gold. They used to send the police, Gondo Arishai, with new tunics, with new trenchants, with new boots, with new radios, to chase young people trying to dig gold. When the history of this country is about people digging gold, we said no. I said no in cabinet. I was in cabinet. And now this industry is supporting the Scotch subcoiners. There are young people, 30, 40, 50,000 of them, digging gold and contributing two-thirds of gold to the national coffers. This is the record of the Second Republic. We are building the largest steel plant in Africa today. We will be in the top league in the next 4 to 5 to 6 years. If you go from, he's an educated man. If he doesn't want to drive to Chivu to go and see what is there, it's only 2 hours away, to see a giant steel plant mushrooming, sprouting out of the red soils of Manize.
Do you owe me a trip to?
Yes, we can go together. This is the top man in steel in the world who has been attracted by Emmerson Dabuzo Mnangagwa even after Grace Mugabe tried to frustrate him to reinvest in Zimbabwe, starting with Ferrochrome in Selu, now coking coal in Wange, which is now a booming town. Wange is booming right now as we talk. It's a booming town, Wange. Go and see the Tongas there, the Nebeles there. They're a completely new town. The third stage is the steel plant in Chivu. The implications from 1.2 million tons of steel come March next year is 5 to 6 million tons of cargo, whether it be ferrochrome, coking coal, whether it be exported steel, whether it be limestone. This is going to revive the railways. This is being done by the Second Republic. We are building planning new ports in Mozambique. So I don't know what he's talking about. You tried at 9 or 5 o'clock today already now, going to watch it through the window of this building. Cars everywhere. No queues for fuel. Everybody's going to buy fuel without having a queue. People are not starving. If you are oblivious to that as the opposition, when the electorate on 26 March was aware of those things and judged us accordingly, then you stumble into an election in a bad manner, and all you then do is when you lose, because you are deluded to think that change is not happening when it changes before your eyes. The electorate will put an X for change in 2023. These guys will be out of power because of their sordid record of non-performance, but also because of their ostrich approach to the changes which are being wrought by the Second Republic. They are burying their head into the sand when the electorate is seeing something totally different in Emmerson Dabuzo Mnangagwa. I know, because I am a prime player in the huge world-class investments which are being done by the Second Republic to change this country. That's why the IMF says the economy is growing at 5.5%. It's their friend. And what is their record? Him, his boss, went to Washington. What does he do in Washington? He doesn't quote businessmen. He quotes a disgruntled congressman to say put sanctions on Zimbabwe. And when you put sanctions, who is the first one to be clobbered by sanctions? The first victim, urban areas. What does he do? No factories. No factories, no workers. No workers, no trade union movements. For a part which came from the trade union movement, it destroys the livelihood of workers. then it destroys itself. That's why in 2023, I'm very sorry, we are going to see the results. But your party is history in 23 because you are oblivious to the big changes where yellow metal in this country, yellow metal means bulldozers. The whole country is a construction site. Roads are being built, railways are being revived, steel plants are being bought. New towns are being built in Mount Hamden. We're going to build a new one again in Chivu. And you are not seeing all those things. The electorate thinks it is not seeing. X will come from an electorate which is really changing its life with Pumputsa, not from the delusions which are the hallmark of this party.
But you appear to say that there are no factions. There's nothing that is coming out of Zimbabwe right now because of sanctions. But in the same vein, you are saying that this whole country is a construction site, you're creating jobs. I'm failing to find...
I'm saying that historically there have been sanctions which destroyed the economy of this country. And Mugabe did not know how, or he was actually abetting. Incidentally, their party and Mugabe are the same. DG40 and FDC.
But Mugabe survived in office because you begged him as well.
No,
him in office and you removed him when you wanted.
We kept him in office when the threat was from the West. You don't open, I would think they are when the enemy is at the gate. So when we saw that there was a chance now to do away with Mugabe, we did away with Mugabe in a very surgical manner, where even they themselves became part of that process. We built a broad united front. It was also to their credit that for a change there was wisdom. And it's just that the wisdom died with the demise of Tsvangirai. Then afterwards, the party was afflicted with its usual, falling to the Western countries. Now those Western countries which they used to worship, look at them in Ukraine. I bet you will not get a cent now from supporting from those Western countries. That's why your president is going to London to see fringe people like Kate Hoy. Hey, Mr. Boris Johnson, they are busy dealing with Putin in Ukraine. This party belongs to foreigners, and that badge of foreigners is one which they must shed. If they can shed it off, and he goes back to what he said earlier about the pedigree of Zimbabwe as a country which was fought for, we come together with them. We have no problem with them as an opposition. It's in the constitution. We'll be very happy to work to build Zimbabwe. But if they've got an attitude where they say we want to disparage those who fought, we are blind to the changes which ZANU PF are doing to make this country livable, and they don't want to give credit where it is due, we don't want credit from them, we want credit from the electorate. We'll focus on the electorate.
I'll give you a last opportunity for rebuttal, then we move on to the
The most astonishing presentation that I got from my brother is that he is trying to boast about building an airport in Maputo, in Mozambique. People don't eat an airport built in Maputo. Maputo is not Zimbabwe. He cannot pride himself for having exported the development that must be done domestically to a foreign country, and then he asks the people of Zimbabwe to clap their hands over a port that we are told exists in a foreign country on behalf of our country. That's absolutely scandalous. Secondly, it is very, very, very insulting for my brother Chris Mchamba to think that the people of Zimbabwe are stupid enough for them not to know the truth. For him to allege that we are foreigners in our own motherland, and that millions and millions of people who support and voters are foreigners, it's absolutely shocking. He has been boasting here that he has been able, when he was the ambassador in China, for him to open up a relationship with the Chinese people and so forth. Where Zimbabwe is currently being turned into a colony of China. If you go into the mining sector, and wherever we go, the Chinese have taken over the operations of small miner, working facets in our country. anything that is currently breathing, a beat is only by the Chinese. So these are the people we have, who are responsible for having abdicated the sovereignty of our people to foreigners. Secondly, my brother, I always meet him, and he boasts that he has opened up relations with the Americans on behalf of President Idris, on behalf of Emmerson Mnangagwa's government. So shocking that they themselves are the ones who always come out in newspapers and also boosting in public place and wherever they go about their newfound relationship with the West. For them only to turn around that when the West makes very fundamental demands to them that respect human rights, respect the will of the people, for us to be your friends. We can only be your friends when you respect the following. Respect the sovereignty of your people to elect leaders of their own choice. Don't kill opponents in your country. Don't incarcerate and arrest unnecessarily political activists who are opposed to the way how you run your country. You must be able for you to show that you are a nation among the civilized societies of the world today, as the world is now a global village. This party is responsible for the murder of several political activists in our country. We cannot forget what they have been doing since 1980 up to present. We cannot finish to mention them by name. The world does not forget that this political party, like to his own admission, has been looting the national cake. They admitted that no, that has been done during the period of Robert Mugabe's government. But behaving as if he was not, behaving as if Emmerson Mnangagwa was not part of Robert Mugabe's government from 1980. These people have been part and parcel of the failure, the authors of this demise of our nation from 1980 up to present. For 42 years, they've been working together. They've been only fighting on who roots more than the other. There is no one who could dispute the corruption in this country, where even a government and its other surrogates and other functionaries would go as far as stealing the money belonging to COVID-19, a pandemic that had affected the whole world. Who stole the drugs? Who is the author of the drugs scandal? Who are the beneficiaries of that huge scandal against our people? Why is our hospital now a sorry state where a person would only be taken to hospital on his way to death? Why is this government has failed even to improve the education sector of our country? How would a government that claims to have achieved a lot still pays a teacher 24,000 RTGS, which is $100 in the modern world of today? How would a government that claims that they have achieved a lot have a nurse being paid 32,000 RTGS a salary? A medical doctor, 7 years after university, for him to give service to this country, being salaried 45,000 RTGS. I once got hold of a public prosecutor, during December, including bonus. It was 42,000 RTGS. A public prosecutor, a major state in our country, still going on the road trying to wait for leaves to go home in a country that has been 42 years independent. We know during the period of Ian Smith and even Abel Mzorewa, teachers would be owners of general dealers in rural villages. They will be drivers of the Mazda B1600 motor vehicles. They will be the owners of the majority of houses in our high density suburbs today. During the period of these people, a teacher is not able to purchase 500 bricks out of his salary. 500 bricks. The salary which teachers are getting cannot buy 500 bricks. For so, how long will that person take to be able to construct even a boy sky? And this is the results of these people's 42 years destruction of our country. Our country needs reconstruction. It needs new focus. It needs new leadership. It needs young people with a vision. The young people who will be able to show the world that they are now living in the new world of technology, the 21st century. And that can only be provided for by the PPC under the leadership of the young advocate Nelson Chamisa. He is a young leader with a new modern vision for the nation. He will make Zimbabwe the greatest country in Southern Africa.
Okay.
When these people took over Zimbabwe, Zimbabwe was the second richest country from South Africa in 1980. Zimbabwe was the breadbasket of Africa. Now it's a basket case. Zimbabwe is now on, is now number four from the list of being the poorest country in Africa, after having been destroyed by these people.
Okay, let's move on to the next topic because we are fast running out of time. But I wanted to understand, the going into this election, Comrade Mchangwa, there has been allegations of vote rigging. There have been allegations of ZEC behaving unprofessionally. Now, yesterday, just when you had a press conference at ZANU-PF, you spoke about how these elections were well managed. Let's talk about that.
Well, they won 19 seats out of 28 from their own rivals in the MDC. Who did we provide the hunting ground for them? It is the ZEC. And they've become quiet about the fact that they won when they were did a cacophony of criticisms of ZEC as they went to the election. Their main point of failure as a party is their lack of respect for the national institutions of their own country. They quarrel with the police, they quarrel with the army, they quarrel with the ZEC, they quarrel with the courts. Now, these are newborn infants. All these institutions are older than them, than their party. You know, if the MTC, it comes 20 years later after the Zimbabwean independence. Yet they come in, they want to come and give a rebirth of their mothers and fathers. They want to give birth to their mothers and fathers. They have no respect for these institutions. That's why they go to America and go to the West and give those countries the responsibility of choosing how Zimbabwe should be run. When it took 90 years of Zimbabweans to fight to make sure that we get rid of those countries, now they go phoning to them to say you are the standard bearers of what how this country should be run. You saw him openly admiring Ian Smith. What does that mean? It means 100,000 Zimbabwean souls who fought from 1966 to 1979 and died for this independence. They died in vain because Smith was good. That's what he said. You know, because he's spending all his time adulating, you know, praising Ian Smith and Rhodesia. Now, where can we go with people like that? This is Africa. We are Africans. We took the pain of removing those people because there was a cause to do so. He's saying there was no cause. Now, you know, you think the electorate, which lost everyone, every Zimbabwean family lost somebody in that war. It's in vain because the MDC says Smith was good. That's precisely why they cannot make inroads, particularly in rural areas where the people bore the brunt of the fighting. But worse now in urban areas, because they went to the West and invited sanctions which destroyed urban cities. They invited them. Chamisa has got a picture with an American senator who wrote Zidera, which is still on American statutes, saying don't make Zimbabwe prosper because we wanted to get rid of Mugabe. This is what I mean, that sanctions mean. They were wrote by Coltart and Welshman Nube. They were responsible, and they wrote those sanctions and gave the copy to the Americans, and the Americans then voted and put a stamp to it. This is their record.
So they are that powerful, are you saying, to influence the United States and America?
It's not that they are that foreign, not powerful. If you're a bootlegger, you always remain a bootlegger. So that's who they are. It's not courage, it's not gumption. It's bootlicking. That is, they have to shed off that image. That's why, maybe because of these elections now, that they sorted themselves among the MDC. We are hoping that because their president yesterday started speaking a different language, maybe because he's used to settle scores within the MDC. Now that he feels he has won against Bonzora, maybe he feels a heavy pounder. Maybe he can take a responsible attitude towards national affairs. And just now, speaking of dialogue, we don't want to be exclusive when we speak of dialogue. We want to include everybody. Because look, with this two-thirds majority in parliament, we could also easily say, why should we talk to Chamisa? Because he only has got 60-something seats. You know, he says, no, 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 two is better than half. We could also say 10 is better than two. So we are not saying that. We say everybody should come. You know, you may lose, but you still love your country. That's why we have Poland. That's why our president is saying it's inclusive. Now they want to be accepted out. But by being accepted, we also accept ourselves and say we wait for the elections in 2023. Then we see who is the proper ring with the proper cock in the ring. That's what will happen because we are very confident. What he is talking about is the past. The electorate is talking about the present, about Vuvuzela. And incidentally, for a landlocked country to build ports in Mozambique, it's a matter of national survival. You may not know, the Munungutapas had a port at Vilanculos, which was built in granite from Mazimbu, like Great Zimbabwe. There's no granite there in Mozambique on the coast. The granite came by the Save River to build a port. So the history of Zimbabwe and Mozambique is one. We are going to Durban 2,000 kilometers away to export. That's $3,000 more per container as inflation to the Zimbabwean economy, because a container costs only $800 from Shanghai or London to get to Durban. To get to Zimbabwe by land from Durban, 2,000. We try to solve that by having new ports in Mozambique and having new railways to Mozambique so that we lower the inflation. But because of the crass ignorance about modern economic management of this party and the poverty of theory, which makes their president boss that he has no ideology, he has no structure, he doesn't care about anything, he just cares because I've got my diploma here, we are the smart ones in this country, we don't need structures. Because there's crass ignorance, lack of appreciation of organization, no respect of history, and general lack of knowledge about how the world moves around. That's the end of this thing. Zec did a fantastic job. Yes. It's a national institution. It's not perfect. But look, it gave them an opportunity, even as they are a recast MTC, to show who they are against Monzora. And they also showed themselves short against ZANU-PF in the same election. So you can't have your cake and eat it. You can't say, I want the result against Monzora, but I don't want the result against ZANU-PF. In the same race. We ran the same race.
But you think there's anything that needs to be changed in the manner that we run elections? You said ZEC is not perfect. What are the imperfections that you think?
There's always room for improvement. The road to democracy is long. Even for the Americans, look at what happens. They can't really allow black people to vote until recently, and they still try to marginalize black people. Trump openly, you know, uses the police to kill black people. This is the most democracy which they admire. You know, the Americans go and destroy Ukraine in order to settle scores with Russia. You know, this is their democracy. It goes and destroys Afghanistan. That's what they wanted to do with Zimbabwe. They wanted Zimbabwe toast in 2004 so that the MDC could win power of a toasted country, a country which has been bombed to break toast by America. This is the lack of proper patriotic credentials, which I hope now that they have sorted themselves out and there's a certain sense of maturity coming in. I hope Nelson continues to improve. We have no problem with the Zimbabweans having differences. What we do have is one country to run. And incidentally, now that your councillors have won, some of them in these urban areas, can they go and remove rubbish? Don't say I cannot remove rubbish because July is stopping me from removing rubbish. Don't go and say children swimming in sewage because July Moyo and the Minister of the local government is stopping from us doing that. You go and do your job. If you don't do your job this time and you blame July Moyo, come 2023, the voter will teach you a lesson because that's what you are used to. You don't do your job, you stay in St. Mary's, there is stinking garbage all over the place. Children have no running water. You know there are no jobs which you are creating. The cars cannot be driven because there are potholes, and you are in charge of St. Mary's, and you still want to say July Moyo is doing. Why do you get to be voted if you think July Moyo is going to stop you from doing the job? Why not let July Moyo run the cities and take the blame rather than get the voter under false pretenses? Please, 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 be responsible for the vote which you canvassed and deliver clean roads, they have paved roads, running water, collected garbage. That's what you are elected for, not to blame July Oil or the central government.
I'll give you the opportunity for the response.
No, that's fine. The first thing that I want to correct my brother Mchangwa about is that I was adulating Ian Smith. No, I was not adulating Smith. I was saying that these people's performance in terms of governance in this country is worse than that of Ian Smith. Ian Smith, despite running a segregated economy, was able for him to understand how much a teacher must obtain. These people have pauperized our people. Teachers are now paupers in their own country. And also Ian Smith, when he was fighting against those great nationalists who have been demanding independence in our country, he said by my brother Mchangwa to have killed about 100,000 people, 100,000 blacks, because he wanted to maintain white supremacism. But these people from 1980 up to present have killed more than 500,000 people in our country through political genocide. We know what they did in Matabeleland from 1980. We know what they did to the Balinese supporters in 1990 when he came back from the United States of America. We know what they did to the MTC since its inception to present. The genocide committed during the period of Kuklawundi and the genocide committed in 2008 cannot be expected to have been committed against your own people. So these people are worse than Ian Douglas Smith in terms of the way how they have killed the black people in this country. So they are a new black Ian Smith, who the people of Zimbabwe must reject, that these people have been running a segregated economy, where only those people in ZANU-PF like him, that's why he is boasting, to say come to Chichibu and see the plant that I am running there. But every single person in Zimbabwe who belongs to the opposition, who wants to run business in this country, is bound to support and attacked. They have got that primitive accumulation of wealth mentality which belongs to them, that we must be the only ones who should eat in this country. And these people have been eating from 1980 up to present. And you would wonder what kind of throats have they been given a different throat from all other Zimbabweans, in that they cannot get satisfied for 42 years eating and eating, looting and eating, looting and eating, looting and eating. So these people have got an unquenchable thirst for greatness. Secondly, so misleading. My brother saying that it has been our president advocate Nelson Chamisa went to the United States of America.
He did.
And pleaded for sanctions. He knows well that he is the propaganda chief. I'm not the propaganda chief
of the CCC.
I'm not the propaganda chief of the CCC. See, maybe if he could have been on the debate with Fazema, I would have expected those statements. He knows it's purely rubbish. It's not the truth. It's not supported by any audio, video evidence. He wants to show us a picture of two people or three people standing on a corner having a picture. I've had many pictures with you, but I'm not ZANU-PF. I'm simply having a picture with you because you are one person whom I can talk to.
We are
brothers, yes.
So
but
what is the brotherhood between Senator Kunz and Chamisa in this picture?
What is the relationship between Emmerson Mnangagwa and those British lords whom he had pictures with when he went to Scotland? Nelson Chamisa is a major political player in this country. Advocate Nelson Chamisa is a major political player in this country. Wherever he goes, even at airports, he is the face of democracy in the world. Wherever he lands, he attracts the attention of even billionaires in the world to say this is a democracy fighter from Zimbabwe. This is a champion for democracy in Zimbabwe. Then they will ask to have selfies with him. He cannot run away from people as if he is uncivilized. But yourself, you have been even praising. You have been given smiles by Johnson. You have been even claiming to have held a very successful meeting with Biden. When in actual fact you knew, my brother, that was a misinformation, a lie from your Nikki Magwana and your George Sharamba. They claimed that your Mnangagwa had a meeting with Biden in Scotland, which was purely a lie. Why do you want to praise yourselves when you meet those people whom you say, when we are seen in cabinet with a member of parliament, who would simply say, I want to have a greeting with you and
can
have
we, can
a,
we, a, can a, we a, go a, to the issue
so
of
So the issue of sanctions again.
Completely.
So the issue of sanctions,
we want to debate.
I remember one of your greatest speeches that has changed even the mindset of Zimbabweans about you. Mm. When you stood up and said, a leader who consistently pontificate about sanctions, that leader is a failure. Mugabe has been complaining about sanctions for 20 years, and he has failed to get the formula to defeat those sanctions. So he is, that is your greatest speech of all times. Even when you die, it will be remembered that Chris Lumumba has given the Zimbabwean the correct narrative
and
position about sanctions. So for you today again to come back and make a somersault, to come and make a change to statements, why this you have clearly told us that a leader who fails for 20 years to defeat one enemy attack is a failure. So you are now admitting to us that you are a failure. In terms of the elections, you know that you even tried to vote by on the eve of elections. You have been distributing millions all over the place in Zimbabwe.
It's a drought.
In all areas that we have.
But it's a drought. You want people to serve.
So they only have to eat when elections are there tomorrow? No. Can you bring the same millions next week in St. Mary's? We saw you were even waiting at the polling station with bags of millimil and trying to say if you go there, you can go and you have even put posters right next to the polling stations during the day of voting. In rural areas, people have been frog marched to go and register their names first before a crawl head, before they went into the polling stations. Is that the electoral process that you want us to believe in this country? Do you know that the people who have been voting, there was somebody who was recording all the names of people getting into the polling station before they voted at each and at the doorsteps of a polling station. In all polling stations throughout the country, they asked for their names, details, address, and their phone numbers. An intimidation tactic which ZEC applied in complicity with your political party. And also, don't try to patronize national institutions. Don't think the people in the military are as foolish as you want to portray it to the people. They know that you have missed the goals and aspirations of the liberation struggle. Many of them talk to us. They even understand how you have betrayed the will of our people. That's why Tendai Biti would win with 2,890 votes at Chikurupi Maximum Prison and at support unit, while this was unfair of country to get 890. Because these people were only showing you a middle finger, saying you are fools, don't patronize us, we don't fight police officers, we don't fight the army, we don't fight. These are institutions, we want them, we want a soldier when retired will be able to go to his home. With the Zambia government, a soldier has currently paid 42,000 RTGS.
Okay,
I'm just. He's not able to send his child to school.
We are running out of time. I'll allow you the last opportunity to respond, then we can close this program. It was getting heated, but over to you for direct response, Comrade Chang.
Well, the only takeaway is that he finally concedes that he has to respect our national institutions, including the army.
You know that I respect the army. No. You have been even talking to me privately,
saying you
respect the army. Please don't say it's the first step. My brother, you have been telling me.
Okay.
Thank you, because you respect the reparations.
We have been having a civil conversation.
Yeah, that's no, we still have it.
So it's also a matter of kudos to ZEC that even those who are in the uniformed forces vote the way they want. This is because they are given an opportunity. But he has been mouthing a litany of accusations against ZEC, as if ZEC is an instrument of ZANU-PF. when it is not. Yesterday, on 26th April, it proved it is not by giving them 19 seats out of their spoils as the opposition. Can you, for a change, go and apologize to Justice Priscilla Chigumba and say, please, what we were saying about you was not true because the result has made us win? Can we have some sense of contriteness and go and apologize for besmirching him, for the calumny which you have been throwing at Zek when it actually makes you win and you are coming here to boast about that win? Please own up, you know, and be decent and go and apologize, or at least give a part to the institutions. Furthermore, you have had a bad history. Maybe now that you have settled your scores with Mwanzora, there can be a sense of maturity, because they are used to petty battles. You have won your petty battle against Mwanzora. The big battle is against the NPF. Maybe because you now feel pumped up after winning Mwanzora, can you go on a course of national responsible governance so that we talk and make Zimbabwe move forward as a nation? Don't try to constantly be, you know, bad-mouthing those whom you know are going to be the majority rule government with whom you must entreat. Being responsible opposition means taking your voters' choice seriously. Don't abandon parliamentary debates. Don't walk out on the president of the republic when he goes into parliament and say we don't want to be associated. Don't expect the same person to then, you know, respect you if you don't give him the due respect which the constitution is giving you by giving you Zek, which gives you results. So please try to build upon your newfound sense of winning from 26 April and be positive. Thirdly, please cut your umbilical cord to those in the West who do not mean well for your country. Because those who impose sanctions against your country, they don't mean well for you. They will increase the poverty of this country. You say you are looking very fit, maybe even more fit than me today. But you are saying that we are looters. But you know, if you look at the between the two of us, you are doing very well.
It means no, but you know, I'm a lawyer.
Yeah. So
it's I'm in a profession that pays.
That pays. You see, yeah. This is good. That's what Zimbabwe has done to you. That's what ZANU-PF has done to you. To give you a first, you when I went to university to study law, well before you could go to even primary school, I was the only black lawyer who could have qualified, and a few others. It was all white. ZANU-PF has made you become lawyers. Galo. Teaching. We had to go to Cuba to train 6,000 teachers in our former military camps because parents were building schools more than at any other time in the history of this country. That's why we're the high literacy rate of this country. That's why our Zimbabwean diaspora performs in Dubai, it performs in London, because ZANU-PF made them what they are. They are world-class citizens earning in hard currency jurisdictions abroad, because ZANU-PF government over the years made them what they be, including you. But here you are, you can't even say thank you for being made to be what you are. You could have been a village head boy there in the rural area under Ian Smith, you know, with Batawiza. But you know, we changed your life. Please give us the credit for the things which we did for you, because this is the history of the country. You respect that, we can build upon the positives. Yes, there have been negatives. We also can criticize the negatives which we have done. But the opportunity is now that you have been given a responsible position by Zek in the last elections. Take it seriously. Go and clean the rubbish in St. Mary's. People don't need that rubbish. And say, I'm repeating to you, if you don't clean that rubbish in St. Mary's, first, we go ZANU-PF, we have an urban renewal agenda. We will be taking you to task daily. And I am the information man of ZANU-PF. My cameras will every day be focusing on that pit of faces which is in St. Mary's, because you are responsible as elected councillors in St. Mary's to remove that. That's what I'm telling you. If you don't, I'm going to make sure that in 2023 you are exposed to the electorate and you will not get a vote, because they will associate you with feces in the street. They will associate you with garbage.
They will associate you with no running water. They will associate you with roads which have been disappeared, because that is the responsibility of you in St. Mary's as elected councillors, as elected MPs. So please go and do your job.
Thank you very
much. This is what you are elected for.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We have just gone over our stipulated time, but because this was a very important national discussion that the people of Zimbabwe really need to listen to, the road to elections, the urban vote here on Free Talk in proud partnership with the Frederick Newman Foundation. But before we go, I'll just give my speakers here just 2 minutes, under 2 minutes, to make their conclusions. Whoever wants to start.
Well, yes, that was what I just said. I don't want to monopolize.
No, you started when the debate debate started. So you cannot start and close. So I should close because you are the one who have been given the first opportunity by the moderator. And I must be the last one to speak because you started to speak. So if I could have been the one who started to speak, I would have accepted to close.
What I'm saying is that the elections went well on the 26th of March. You came out well ahead of your rivals within your fractious opposition. You failed to make any inroads against the ZANU-PF strongholds. This is an indicator that your message is not getting through into the ZANU-PF stronghold. And since we already hold two-thirds, if you cannot win seats away from the two-thirds, you cannot hope to be a governing party in 2023. Additionally, we took two seats away from what were traditional MDC, now TPC strongholds. It means that our message, our president is getting through to the electorate to get seats from you. Thirdly, we won a clutch of council seats in local government elections, most of them again in urban areas. It means that the urban electorate is beginning to make you accountable as city fathers for their day-to-day lives of the sordid nature of your city administration. These are things which you need to care for. Please, can you go and make sure that we do something about those things? Garbage, and collect, you know, sewage, you know, no running water. Because you are a government, you collect rates from the people, you collect their votes first, then you collect rates from them. These are the issues which you have to sort without with your electorate. If you can't sort that without you, with your electorate, we will sort it out for you using executive powers. But more than that, we will tell the electorate that the people whom you elect to government, they are eunuchs, they are political eunuchs. They can't be councillors. Majomos, that's what we'll tell the electorate. And you will lose the elections in 2023. So be very careful about your new responsibilities now, because you've won your petty little fight against Monzora. The big fight is against ZANU-PF. We are going to give you a tsunami if you don't measure up. Measure up or ship out. That's my last word.
Thank you.
Is that anybody who would not see the red light on the magnificent performance of our electoral defeat of ZANU-PF at the during the previous by-elections, that person needs to be examined in his mind. We want to thank the people of Zimbabwe for having given us the greatest mandate ever given to a political party of 2 months old to defeat a more than 60-year-old political party that has been there in existence, but has been given the run for its money by a 2 months-old political party. So the people of Zimbabwe, you have clearly demonstrated that you are now ready for you to give the alternative young leadership the opportunity to steer the nation towards modernization, towards the new world, where we will be able to deliver a first-class medical facilities in our country, first-class transport system, first-class road networks, first-class developments, and a rapid industrialization in our country, where we will be able to harness all the talents of our Zimbabweans, both domestically and those who have been pushed into diaspora because of the failure of the 42 years of rulership by ZANU-PF in our country. We have got a lot of talent, a lot of many Zimbabweans, experts dotted throughout the world. We want them back to for the reconstruction of our country. We need their expertise. Our country is going to be transformed into a first world country within the first 3 years. We are going to exceed the rapid development that we saw happening in Rwanda, the one that has happened in other African states. Our infrastructure is going to be the first one and the first class in Africa. And we are going to restore Zimbabwe where it was in 1980 before it was taken by looters who have looted everything for their own sake and to the destruction of our country. Zimbabwe was the second richest country in Africa. It's now number four poorest country. It's now on the number four poorest country in Africa, where the rate of unhappiness in our country is regarded as number one in the whole world. That our people are the most unhappy ones. They are dotted throughout the Southern African region.
Was being
ridiculed there, where they are being attacked and banged on the day because of the failures of ZANU-PF. So we want to restore the dignity of our Zimbabwean people, whose dignity has been destroyed by this political party that has been in existence for the past 70 plus so years since 1963.
So
and it has been in power for 42 years, destroying every aspect of humanism in our country. CCC is the future. CCC is the new gambling town. Join CCC as soon as possible before it is too late. I thank you for the wonderful interview, my brother Blessing. This has been one of the greatest interviews I have had with you. And through my brother, it has been a civilized engagement. It was an intellectual chiso here. And I really enjoyed it. My brother Mshambo. We thank you very much for this debate.
Thank you for finally realizing that ZANU-PF can give you proper elections.
Amazing. Thank you very much, viewers, for joining me here, Dara Blessed Mtyanga, with Madara Madara from CCC and ZANU-PF. Now, a democracy is an exchange of ideas. It is the better ideas of the day that should govern the country. Democracy should be minus violence, should be about ideas, it should be about building the nation. And here, at Heart and Soul TV and Radio, in proud partnership with the Frederick Newman Foundation, we lay the foundation for dialogue. We lay the foundation for Zimbabweans to listen to themselves, to listen to each other, and be able to build their country together. We are all one. This is our country. We belong here. Like the president always says, we do not have any other except this. And like president of the CC always says, let us battle with ideas. I thank you very much for the amazing debate that we have had, Honorable Mtyangwa, Ambassador. Say,
thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
We
thank
are.
You. Take care.
Take care, my brother.
This is the Free Talk, Frederick Newman Foundation on Heart and Soul TV and Radio. Dara Nderenyu, Ndiniwenyu. Thank you very much.